Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for another fellowship. I thank you for another opportunity, Lord, for us to come together, Lord, to get into your word. Lord, open up your scriptures to us, Lord, that we get right understanding. Lord, touch everyone that's viewing this program today, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, touch them in a special way, Lord. You know every need, Lord. You know every need. And I pray, Lord, that you meet all the needs, Lord, of every viewer out there, Lord. Please meet the need, Lord, whether it be financial, whether it be health-wise, whether it be housing or food situation or clothing, whatever the need is, Lord, whether it be somebody to come and help them, Lord God, you know every need. You know every need. You know every need, Lord. You know every need. And you are able to answer every need. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hi, Mother. How you doing today, Mother? Mother Williams, how you doing? God bless you. Sister Mabel, God bless you. We pray that the Lord continues to strengthen you. And both of you, continue to strengthen your bodies. My Lord God, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, to my Aunt Teresa, my brother Larry, who right now is in the hospital. But Lord, we pray, because we know that you are a healer, Lord, and a reviver, a rejuvenator, and you can strengthen every limb, every bone, and every muscle, and every joint, Lord. Strength, Lord, right now, Lord, strength, Lord, right now. Right now, Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus, to all the seniors that are watching, yes, I think about you, I pray for you, and I hope that God, my Lord, answer your needs. Answer every need, Lord, answer every need. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, right now, in Jesus' precious name, we give you glory and honor, we magnify you, we adore you, Lord God, and we love you. We love you, Heavenly Father, we love you. And we thank you right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hi, and how you doing today? Hope that you are ready to get into the word of the Lord. Hope that during the time that we were not together, that you were reading the word and getting deeper and deeper in the word and developing a stronger and stronger relationship with God. It is so important to have a right and strong relationship with God. Do you realize that some people believe they have a strong relationship with God, but it's not a right relationship with Him? We need a right relationship with the Lord. Some people believe that their relationship is strong as long as they go to church every Sunday. Some people believe that their relationship with God is strong as long as they do the right thing, that they're not committing fornication or adultery, but they might be lying. They could be stealing. They could be doing something that they think is insignificant. They could be doing something that they're not even thinking that they are doing. They may have the means to help somebody, but they won't do it. They may have an opportunity that God has availed to them to be of assistance to someone, but they turned their back on that person. That's not a right relationship with God. We are to be doers of the word. And the word tells us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. And where they are lacking, and if we have to be able to give or to share, then we should be willing to do it in the name of God, not seeking glory or fame. Some people, you know, they do things and then, then they stand up in the middle of the church and then they confess, you know, I did such and such. I did this and that, you know, and then they'll start talking about what they did. We don't have to announce what we have done before anyone. And if you examine the word, you will find that Jesus healed some people and told them not to go and tell. Of course, now he's Jesus. He didn't have to be magnified by anyone because he was going to be glorified regardless. And he was glorified. It is peculiar the way things, the turn of events, the way things turned out. And what makes it so peculiar, because all of those people that he cast out demons and all those people that he raised from a sick bed, gave their limbs to come back into operation, gave them to be able to walk. Limp limbs came strong and were usable. People who couldn't talk and were dumb, had a dumb spirit, gave them to hear and to speak. People who were blind, he opened up their eyes. People who were laid on a sick bed and couldn't get up, he got them up. There were people in the tomb and he raised them from the grave. Yet there was not one person that stood up for him when it came time for somebody to stand and say, yes, I know him. Yes, I know him. I did not see, he did not do anything bad. He didn't say anything wrong. He did not blaspheme, but it was not to be. And that which is not to be will not be. Out of all of those thousands and thousands of thousands upon people who were healed and saved and demonic spirits released and people raised from the grave, it was not for any of them to say a word. Because it was for Jesus to go to that cross. And it was for him to go humbly, not showered with people testifying about all his marvelous works. No, it wasn't about that. It was about him being a pure, clean, sanctified, holy, and acceptable my Lord, and an acceptable sacrifice unto God. He had to be holy. He had to be clean, without sin, without blemish or mark, to go to the cross that we might all be saved as an atonement for our sins, that we could all become redeemed and restored in the sight of God. If you accept what Jesus has done for you, if you believe that he went to the cross and in 3 days that he rose and that he is the Son of God, then they say at the altar, then you have been saved. You have been purged. And now you have become a joint heir. But that's not all it takes. That's not all it takes. There's some sanctification that must go on. Some separation. Some purifying, and my Lord. Thank you, Jesus. There's some things that need to go on in that process to make you whole, because you're a broken vessel. You got to be purged and cleansed of your iniquity. That brokenness must be fixed so that you are no longer broken, but you're a new creature in the eyes and the sight of God, walking in the steps that he has ordered, living as he has ordained us to live, doing as he would have us to do. You are a new creature in God. You speak different. You look different. You walk different. You dress different. Everything about you is different because you are no longer who you used to be. I don't know. There's so many people who become saved, right? Who truly became saved and some became different. And they go meet up with some, you know, maybe you might, a lot of times it's family member. Oh, you ain't changed. You're trying to act like you so saved and sanctified. And some of these people that they're talking to really are trying to act because they know they're not saved. They can tell by, you know, by the things they're doing and saying and how they act towards their family. But some people have really been saved. And for those who have been saved, the family does recognize a difference. Everybody has to recognize a difference. When people see me, even watching this on this television screen, they know I have been changed. They know that I'm not perpetrating a fraud. He changed me. I'm no longer as I used to be. There are people who come up to me and remember everything that I used to do, how they used to go into the parties and things that I used to do, all the music that I used to play, the things that I used to say. I'm no longer that person. I'm a new person, a new creature in God. I've been changed. I've been purified. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. You need to be purified, sanctified, and washed in the blood of the Lamb. that you might become acceptable in the sight of God, that you might be real and not perpetrating a fraud. So many people in the church are perpetrating a fraud, playing like they're saved and sanctified, and so far removed from it. They're not fooling anybody but themselves, because many of the people in church already know who the frauds are. They do. They know who you are already. They know who the frauds are. My Lord, to God be the glory. Stop perpetrating. Get real. Time is growing near. Time is growing near. And if you have not confessed with your mouth and turned your life totally around and given yourself unto God, then you will go down into the pits perpetrating that thing that you thought was going to keep you from going into the pit. But you can't fool God. There's no fooling him. He knows the heart. He knows the inner man. He knows who we truly are. If scripture tells you he knows every hair upon his head, what do you think that he doesn't know about you? Biblical scripture says he knew us before we were born, before the foundation of this earth or the world was created. He knew us. And he called us by name. He said this to Jeremiah, chapter 1, Jeremiah. When he calls Jeremiah and begins to speak to Jeremiah, he says, I knew you before the foundation of this world. Before your mother and father came together, I knew you. He knew you. He knew me. He knew what we were going to be, what we were going to say, what we were going to do, under what circumstances we would say it. He knows what our beginning is and our end. He is the great Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He is the creator of all things. And without his son, Jesus, was not anything created. Biblical scripture in John 1 says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And there was nothing created that was not created with him. The Father and the Son are one. And if you're in any kind of religion that does not believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, then you are in a religion that's not going to take you into what you might call paradise, or into destiny, into heaven. Because you cannot get there except through Christ Jesus. And if you do not believe that he is the Son of God, then what you are studying and what you are worshiping and what you are following is wrong. Get into the Word of God and study it for yourself. Get into the book of the Lord, the Holy Bible, the Old Scripture, and the Old Testament and the New Testament. Get into the King James Version. Don't go into these dilapidated, made to easy reader and been transformed and made so you can simplify, so you can not have to struggle through. No. Read the Word. Let the Word be so important to you that you don't mind trying to struggle through it and trying to pronounce stuff. And he will open it up to you, and you will get it. And the thing about the Bible, it's in levels. You can read a verse or a chapter today and tomorrow read it, and you're going to come out with something different. And it's amazing. It is the living Word of God. Study it for yourself. Read the Word. Digest it. Let it become a part of you. It is important that you suck it up like a sponge. He told Jeremiah to eat the roll, but he put his hand to the mouth. He put his hand to the mouth of Jeremiah. He told Ezekiel to eat the roll, which was a scroll at that time. And he said it was like honey, sweet unto him. The Word of God is sweet. It will take you through every situation, every circumstance, every downfall, every thing that is going wrong. It'll take you and carry you through it. He has a scripture for everything. Every ailment, every problem, every situation, every downfall, every turnabout. He has a word for you, and it's in his holy Bible. This is the word of God. It's his holy Bible. And in order to truly grasp a hold of this thing, I'm telling you right now, King James Version. I don't care what T.D. Jakes is reading. I don't care what Juanita Bynum is reading. I don't care what anybody else is reading. You get into this word, the King James Version, and struggle through it. If need be, because he's not going to make it hard for you to struggle through it. Because he's the one who said make it plain. In other words, make it simple. They got to understand it. He's not going to give you stuff you cannot understand. He's not going to give you a word that you can't understand. He doesn't need to simplify it, because as you read it, it will become clear to you because of your heart and your relationship with God. You've got to have that relationship. Outside of that, there are people who read this Bible and it's like reading a book to them. Oh, I've read it 5-6 times. No, I have not read the whole Bible. I have not read it. I don't know when I got saved, but I can tell you that since the time I got saved, I started reading the Bible. And I know it's been over 5 years. It's been well over 5 years. And to this very day, I have yet to read the whole entire word, because I'm not trying to read it as though it's a book. I'm reading it as God leads me to read it. There was a point, and a couple of points, where I started reading from the beginning, going towards the end. And somewhere in there, he led me to other places. And when I went to these other places, I started reading something else. I could have been in the Old Testament, and then he took me to the New Testament, and then he took me here, and he took me there. And as he took me, I went, because he was teaching me something. He was leading me somewhere. He was instilling in me some things he wanted to instill. And I thank him for giving me an ear and a mind.
Amen. See, we can tell if you know Jesus, because you'll always have your mouth open, you'll shake your head, you'll wave your hand, you'll say something. How many of y'all really got a relationship with Jesus Christ? Amen. I want you to act like that tonight. I want you to act like that. This is a roof that is full of the preaching word of God, and certainly revival is set this house every night. And we're so grateful. We want to thank God for our presiding bishop. Let's thank God for our bishop, Bishop Charles Whitman Blake, for allowing us to have this revival fire in this room. It is a blessing, and it's been packed out every night, and I just appreciate you coming. But I need your help tonight. I got to do this, and I got to do it quickly. Something unusual happened in this meeting that really happened in our AIM meeting. We have a short window to work with. So what you see in the AIM convention at Revival Fires, we can't do it here because the time is limited. Right. Y'all understand? Oh, I wish y'all say amen. I need y'all to say something back to me. You make me think you're hearing what I'm saying. We got a short window to work with. And so that's the reason why we're moving so fast and trying to make sure that we keep things blue on tonight, that by this time Tuesday, shout all the way up to Tuesday. It may come before Tuesday.
Thank you.
He saved a wretch like me. God, thank you. Jesus.